That market is very lucrative. In 2020, it will be worth in excess of $20 billion. Now let's look at the aspects of this global market, starting with demand. All economies start with demand and supply. Let's start with demand. There is a total number of about 300 million students, university students, and about 10 million of them are globally mobile. In other words, they're willing to go to different universities, etc. On the supply side, the number of tertiary institutions have increased from 3,500 in 1950 to nearly 20,000 universities. So the supply is increasing, the choice is increasing, and this has been described as massification. Now, on the supply side, what are the motives? The motives to supply education to the global market. First of all, their financial gains. A lot of the movement globally is motivated by finance. But it's not the only motive. If you're going to be a global brand, you need to be present all over the world. You also need to give a student who's looking for to be in the global labor market, needs a global standard education, but needs a global exposure. Come to UWI, they want it. Semester in China and the semester in France, etc. That's what students are looking for. The modes of delivery, there are really three. One, selling on the internet, that's growing rapidly. Secondly, foreign students going to a foreign country to study. And then thirdly, there were universities set up branches, for example. A number of universities with good brand names in the US set up in Singapore and the Middle East because very lucrative. Rather than students traveling over there, they just carry the educational institution to them. So that's happening, and it's happening in the Caribbean. I'm going to come to that. Now, what are the requirements to be in this global market, to supply the global market? First of all, of course, you have to have a good product, or a product that is perceived as comparatively good. Secondly, you have to be competitive in price, because people have to shop price. You also have to have a brand name that's recognizable through being ranked. There are a number of international ranking systems, and good students go first to these ranking systems, and they can tell you, this university is at 150, and this one is at 280, and so on. And you also have to have marketing. This is a competitive business. No matter how good your product is, if you don't advertise it in an imaginative and encouraging way. For example, I saw one university that in selling their product, they said, they didn't say anything about what they offered. They said, we are where your future begins. We are going to do X and Y, all the future things. They said nothing about what they do. But that was a way of saying to people, you're graduating and you're gonna have a long career in the future. We're the stepping stone. So all of that goes into it. Now, I would suggest that all of this means that every university in any part of the world has an imperative to respond to the global market for higher education. And there are two needs to respond to. One is opportunity, but two is defensively. And when we talk about the Caribbean, we're going to see how much competition there is in the Caribbean. Now the question that obviously comes to mind is, the Caribbean, can it really supply the global market with higher education? That question comes up because we are in a situation where 40, 50 years ago, there was a monopoly on higher education in the Caribbean of Caribbean institutions. A few people went abroad, but now there are 150 universities and colleges operating in the Caribbean. There are over 60 universities selling services into the Caribbean. And that means that this little market, the Caribbean market, I think is vastly oversupplied, but there are 150 institutions. And they proliferate. I make no comment on the following. I merely observed that there is a place called the All-American Institute of Medical Science in Black River, Jamaica. And they showed me a picture of a two-story residence. But it just shows you the extent to which there is competition. Because I'm sure they have students or they would be in business. Now, what is our supply capacity in the Caribbean? We have the following kinds of institutions. We have public institutions. UWI being one, UTEC, there are institutions all over the Caribbean, public institutions. Secondly, there are private, non-profit, mainly institutions started by the church, and they have some very respectable universities. And then there are for-profit institutions, both local. We have one that's listed on the Jamaica Stock Exchange, and a number of foreign universities that have set up. Now, these universities seem to be doing very well because they continue to grow. We'll come to that. There's obviously some capacity to supply because there are 10,500 students, medical students in Canada. But there are nearly 4,000 Canadian students who are studying overseas. So it tells you that there's some supply, and many of them are studying in the Caribbean. Now, what else can we note about our capacity to supply? First of all, we have certain disadvantages, and the main one is the disadvantage of small size. But I think there are ways to overcome that. So we have some capacity to supply education in the Caribbean, and that capacity is increasing with these private, foreign, and local institutions. The other question that comes to mind is, okay, so you can supply a degree in economics or geology, but who is demanding this on the global scale? Is there a demand for education from the Caribbean? And I would suggest that there is demand. And I cite the following. One, if you look at the number of institutions that have grown in the Caribbean market, many of them are servicing foreign students. Secondly, the Caribbean has a very strong comparative advantage. Our cost of a degree here is far, far lower than doing it in most of the developed countries, and you're getting a comparable education. I also suggest to you that we have Caribbean content that not only Caribbean people want. There is not only the diaspora, but there's a whole global market out there. When you offer a course in reggae or Caribbean literature, there's a global market for this. And it's a huge market, and it's a growing market. So there is a demand for Caribbean, for education from Caribbean universities. And I add one other thing. One of the selling points for the foreign universities that have operated here is that they present a wholesome environment that people will send their kids to. People feel very comfortable with their kids going to St. Kitts and to Barbados. They may not be as comfortable as some other locations, but the point is that the atmosphere where people send their kids are also important. And the Caribbean, with its wonderful climate, people, tourist industry, is an attractive place. Now, there is a huge unmet demand for higher education. Our open campus, which is teaching by internet, We have maybe about 8,000 students at this time. However, there are, and we're only talking about United Kingdom universities, there are 66 universities selling online through the internet into the Caribbean, and they have 22,000 students. Those are potential students for Caribbean universities. So there is a huge unmet demand out there. I'm not saying there are not other factors. People may want a foreign university degree, whatever. But it shows you that there's a big unfulfilled demand. I cite another thing, which is that we gave one scholarship here for students from Africa. When we went through all the vetting, there were 326 qualified African students who wanted to come and study in the Caribbean. So there is a demand out there. Well, of course, demand has to be effective, but needs to match your resources. But there's a demand out there. Now, I suggest too that there's a